Thank you, Mary Ann, and welcome into Good Shepherd Lutheran Church as we gather for worship this day. Pray the Lord's blessings be upon you, and good to be back with you after our weekend in Texas, and to worship with you once again. So thank you for your prayers. The Lord kept us safe. We had a very nice time down there, and good to be back in Central Illinois. If you are a guest or visitor to our congregation, we welcome you in the name of Christ. We pray the Lord's blessings be upon you, and we do invite you to sign our guest book and to worship with us again in the future. Our order of service for this morning is going to be the service of prayer and preaching. That'll be on page 260 in the front portion of your hymnal. We will, of course, be doing the common responses, since that is where we are at in the church here. And then our hymns all will be out of our hymnal, which is in front of you in the pew rack there, including our opening hymn, which is 941, "We Praise You and Acknowledge You, O God, We Will Stand," on the fourth and final verse.
Thank you.
This is the day which the Lord has made. From the rising of the sun to its setting. Better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. Make me to know your ways, O Lord. Sanctify us in your truth. From the rising of the sun to its setting,
the name of the Lord is to be praised.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Thus, he comforted them
and spoke kindly to them. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our epistle lesson is also on the back of your worship folder this morning, Romans chapter 14, the verses are 1 to 12, and we will read the epistle together as a congregation. We read, "As for the one who is weak in faith, welcome him, but not to quarrel over opinions. One person believes he may eat anything, while the weak person eats only vegetables. Let not the one who eats despise the one who abstains, and let not the one who abstains pass judgment on the one who eats, for God has welcomed him. Who are you to pass judgment on the servant of another? It is before his own master that he stands or falls, and he will be upheld. The Lord is able to make him stand. One person esteems him one day as better than another, while another esteems him all days alike. Each one should be convinced in his own mind. The one who observes the day observes it in honor of the Lord. The one who eats, eats in honor of the Lord, since he gives thanks to God. While the one who abstains, abstains in honor of the Lord, and gives thanks to God. For none of us lives to himself, and none of us dies to himself. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother? Or you, why do you despise your brother? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall confess to God. So then each of us will give an account of himself to God." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Will you please rise from the Holy Gospel? The Gospel is in St. Matthew, the 18th chapter, verses 21 through 35. Peter came up and said to Jesus, "Lord, how often will my brother sin against me and I forgive him? As many as seven times?" Jesus said to him, "I do not say to you seven times, but 70 times seven. Therefore the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his servants. When he began to settle, one was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents. Since he could not pay, his master ordered him to be sold with his wife and children and all that he had in payment to be made. So the servant fell on his knees and implored him, 'Have patience with me and I will pay you everything.' And out of pity for him, the master of that servant released him and forgave him the debt. But when that same servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him, he began to choke him, saying, 'Pay what you owe.' So his fellow servant fell down and pleaded with him, 'Have patience with me, and I will pay you.' He refused and went and put him in prison until he should pay the debt. When his fellow servants saw what had taken place, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their master all that had taken place. Then his master summoned him and said to him, 'You wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. And should not you have had mercy on your fellow servant as I had mercy on you?' And in anger, his master delivered him to the jailers until he should pay all his debt. So also my heavenly Father will do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother from your heart." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We continue our worship now with the responsory, the common responsory. That's on page 263 in the front portion of your hymnal. "Forever, O Lord, your word is firmly set in the heavens. Blessed are those who hear the word of God and keep it."
Lord, have mercy on your house and the place where your glory dwells.
Glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit.
Lord, have mercy on your house and the place where your glory dwells.
We turn to the top of page 264. Our catechism portion is the Ten Commandments, and we say them together. You shall have no other gods. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. Honor your father and your mother. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his manservant, or maidservant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. We confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven. And this at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From this you will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We pray together, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Please be seated. The text we will serve as the base of the message for this morning is our Old Testament lesson. That's from Genesis chapter 50, verses 15 to 21. Dear friends in Christ, as human beings, we love stories of sweet revenge. My dad tells the story of being on the JV basketball team in a small south central Illinois town in the late 1950s. The team he was on was pretty good. They would win some games by quite a lot. My dad, his friend, and a few other teammates were the bench players. Unfortunately, even in their blowout wins, they would not get a lot of playing time. The coach liked to keep his starters in the game. Well, during their last game at home that season, they had another game where they were way ahead. And with very little time on the clock, the coach started to empty his bench and send the players into the game. My dad's friend took his warm-up off, checked into the scorer's table, and then proceeded not to run into the game, but straight into the locker room. The coach stood there, dumbfounded. He had no idea what was going on. This was the player's chance to get back at the coach for never getting him into a game. I laugh every time my dad tells this story. If someone had the right to sweet revenge, it would be the main character in our text for today. That would be Joseph. We will get into his story and see how the Lord can transform evil into good. As most of you know, our text for today is the end of a long story about Joseph and his brothers. Joseph was the 11th of 12 brothers and most beloved by his father Jacob. But Joseph did some things to his brothers that they didn't like, so they conspired to kill him and to throw him down into a pit. And the brothers made it look like Joseph had been killed, and Jacob grieved for his dead son. Except Joseph wasn't dead. He was sold and served Potiphar. He ended up in prison, but he interpreted the dreams for Pharaoh's cupbearer and baker, and then for Pharaoh. So Pharaoh put Joseph in a place of leadership, and he controlled the flow of grain during the famine and the years of plenty. And this is what brought Joseph's brothers to him. With that background, then our text. When Joseph's brothers saw that their father was dead, they said, "It may be that Joseph will hate us and pay us back for all the evil that we did to him." Do you ever have those thoughts? You want to get back at someone who has wronged you? A co-worker takes credit for your work, puts you in a bad light with the boss. Later that same co-worker struggles hopelessly with a project due tomorrow. What do you do? A fellow student bullies you mercilessly. Later she is accused of cheating on a test, but you know she's innocent. What do you do? Your sister talks your aging mother into giving her a precious heirloom that she promised you many years ago, and then your sister sells it. Now your sister needs help with groceries to feed her family. What do you do? The music director asks you to sing a solo for Christmas Eve, and after practicing for several weeks, he asks his grandson to do it. Months later, with only a week's notice, the music director wants you to sing several solos for Easter because his grandson backed out. What do you do? Joseph's brothers threw him in a pit. They let his father think he was dead, and now they come to him for much needed grain. What will he do? These brothers had lived with the guilt, but they had never had a good talk with Joseph about what they had done to him. Sometimes instead of talking with our family and friends, we have the idea that past hurts and sins will just go away if we don't. Bring them up again. They're not confessed and forgiven, they're just forgotten. For a while. But if the topic comes up again, the scab is picked and the bleeding starts all over. And even if we cover it up with, "That's okay," or "Don't worry about it," the healing never happens. The brothers make up a story about Jacob to Joseph and how the father wanted Joseph to forgive them. Their contrition is not genuine, but a desperate attempt to save themselves. Do we play this game with a cake, flowers, a trip away? That's bribery, not repentance and forgiveness. We need to articulate the wrong and then be forgiven. And hearing the words of absolution from the pastor in church, as well as remembering our baptism and receiving Christ's body and blood for the forgiveness of sins, is hearing the voice of God loud and clear that God has forgiven us through the sacrifice and the cross of our Savior Jesus Christ. This is the truth that Joseph knew. He wasn't in the place of God, but God could bring good out of evil. From a blood-stained cloak and a slimy pit to a leader in Egypt with his brother's future in his hands. You know, Joseph could have gone to the scorer's table. He could have checked into the game and he could have kept on running, leaving his brother standing there dumbfounded. But he didn't. Joseph explained that the Lord had a purpose in the brother's evil. God meant it for good so that his family could be reconciled and many people could be kept alive. Those who hated and killed Jesus meant it for evil, but God meant it for good. The saving of many souls, the persecution and the unjust treatment, the killing and the burial and the emerging from the tomb were all part of God's greater plan of ultimate good for you and me. Our sins are no more. Jesus speaks to us today through Joseph. Can we see the good that can come from the evil in our lives? Do you still have a relationship hanging in the balance? Through the power of the Holy Spirit, make that phone call. Write that letter. Let go of your anger and be reminded of the precious love that the Savior has for you. You have been reconciled to Him, and He wants you to be reconciled to others. The Lord can transform evil to good. And we were blessed to see it today. Amen. Our prayer is printed out responsively on page 265, and then toward the bottom there, I also have some additional prayer requests today as well. In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the gift of divine peace, depart with all our heart, with all our mind, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the Holy Christian Church, here and scattered throughout the world, and for the proclamation of the gospel and the call of faith, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this nation, for our cities and communities, and for the common welfare of us all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For seasonable weather and for the fruitfulness of the earth, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who labor, for those whose work is difficult or dangerous, and for all who travel, let us pray to the Lord. Pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all those in need, for the hungry and homeless, for the widowed and orphan, for all those in prison, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the sick and dying, and for all those who care for them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Almighty Father, just as Joseph forgave his brothers and provided for them and their families, let us forgive those who have sinned against us. Grant that we would share with them the gospel of reconciliation in Christ. Merciful Father, guard and keep all who are sick, lonely, overwhelmed by grief, or poor in spirit, especially remembering this morning Dennis Walker, following successful hip surgery this past week, and also Rick Ross's sister, Donna, that they may be comforted and healed according to your good and gracious will. Let them look to Jesus Christ of the world in their time of need, and remind them that he is the light no darkness can overcome. And then we pray for Marianne Kirschner, that you would give her safe travel out to Utah and bless her time out there as she is with her daughter Johanna. We do pray that Johanna's time in Utah has been good for her mentally and physically, and we pray for her baby that is going to be delivered this week. We ask, Lord, that your will would be done, that you would watch over Marianne and Johanna, and especially as you bring them safely back here to our congregation, that you would be with them in the days and weeks ahead and bring good out of all that you can. Lord, in your mercy. Finally, for these and for all our needs of body and soul, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
O God, our refuge and strength, the author of all godliness, hear the devout prayers of your church, especially in times of persecution, and grant that what we ask in faith we may obtain. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Blessed Lord, you have caused all Holy Scriptures to be written for our learning. Grant that we may so hear them, read, mark, learn, and take them to heart, that by the patience and comfort of your holy word, we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We join together as we pray the morning prayer at the top of page 266. I thank you, my Heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have kept me this night from all harm and danger. And I pray that you would keep me this day also from sin and every evil, that all my doings in life may please you. For into your hands I commend myself, my body and soul in all things. Let your holy angel be with me, that the evil foe may have no power over me. Amen. 7, let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Almighty and merciful Lord, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit bless and preserve you. Welcome again in the name of Christ, and if you are a visitor to our congregation, we welcome you especially, and it's great to have you joining with us today. A couple of things. First of all, thank you to everybody who was part of our blood drive on Friday. Everything went well, so if you helped out in any way or gave blood, that is certainly appreciated. Thank you so much. Secondly, if you had your picture taken for our directory a few months back, we now have the books. They are in. Angelina will be back at the table there in the narthex. Please stop by and see her. Pick up your directory. Take a look at it. Get to know your fellow members better. And instead of saying, hi, good to see you, you can say, hi, so-and-so, when you see them. All right? So that helps our fellowship. That's part of the reason we have a directory. And so we're thankful to God for that. Thank you.
Thank you, Pastor, and good morning. I have no other announcement, but I would ask you to check the yellow portion on your service folder for any upcoming meetings or events that you might want to attend. Does anybody else have anything they'd like to